Medical University at Lucknow.
Very good morning to all of you, and I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to be here. And I have basically largely an oral presentation because I did not understand what is the intent of PowerPoint presentation. So I would first tell you a little about India, which you all know. We have approximately 1.3 billion population with an area of 2.3 square million kilometers. Now, this area has a population density of 41 people per square, 416 people per square kilometer. And this can increase to about 21,000 per square kilometer when you go to the cities like Mumbai. So when you're talking about India, you're talking about a country of diversity. There are 29 states in the country and 7 union territories. Now, each state in the country is broken up into districts. And these districts have an average population of approximately 3 to 4 million people. Now, with this background about India, there is no data which is representative of the entire country. And therefore, I would like to tell you what we have data from my country. And before that, I would like to tell you what is the health structure of the country. So the health structure of the country is right from the village. You have rural villages, and for these villages, you have the primary health center, which caters to 30,000 population. This primary health center is established by the government, caters to 30,000 population, has doctors which are qualified, has nurses and other grassroots workers. Besides primary health center, within each village of the primary health center, there is a ANM, that's an auxiliary nurse midwife, and an accredited social activist. When you go above the primary health center, then at the district level, you have community health centers which cater to a population of 100,000 to 200,000, and then you have district hospital. Now, where do I come in? I am a tertiary hospital. I work in a tertiary hospital, which is in a district. And this tertiary hospital is a teaching training hospital. Now, the question which is being discussed here is, do we see cases of fever? What are the cases of fever? And what I understood from here is, fever is the commonest cause of presentation in any hospital, whether it is the primary hospital or whether it is secondary or tertiary. But fever as it comes to us in the tertiary care hospital could be largely fever with localizing symptoms. And fever undifferentiated largely does not come to us unless it is a fever of long duration. That means the duration would be about more than 14 days, and the path followed by this child is coming from different healthcare providers finally reaching us. Now, when I say different healthcare providers, we have people practicing modern medicine, which is us. We have people practicing indigenous systems of medicine, like Ayurveda, like Yunani, like combined together called Ayush, and homeopathy also. And then you have healers, faith healers, and herbal medicine peoples, which are also practicing. So first, let us focus on what we see sitting in a tertiary care hospital. The commonest cause of admission in our hospital, I have the admission data because I thought we would need the admission data, is fever with localizing symptoms, and what we call it is the acute encephalitic syndrome. That is majority of admissions. So a child conscious, suddenly has fever, becomes unconscious, has seizures, and presents to us. Now, we have national guidelines for investigating and managing such patients. Yet, on the basis of investigations, only about 15% or so turn out to be positive for one or more disease. Now, when I say more, I'll tell you what. We get children positive for bacterial meningitis, tuberculosis meningitis. We get children positive for malaria, scrub typhus. And when we do the CSF examination, we get dengue, JE, West Nile, chikungunya, and other viruses coming. Now I say largely one because sometimes we get two viruses reported from CSF. So then we don't know. It's okay. They say dengue positive, chikungunya positive. The issue which comes to us is we have to report all JE cases and dengue cases to the government. So that becomes an issue with us. Then we have, in the treatment protocol, we have national treatment protocol guidelines. We treat the patient with antibiotic. We treat the patient for scrub because scrub diagnosis never comes to us in time. And we treat the patient for malaria till the RDT comes out to be negative. And I was discussing that sometimes, despite RDT negative, we would like to go ahead and complete the combination artesunate treatment. Because maybe this child is behaving like malaria. There's a clinical suspicion, even though RDT is sensitive specific, yet there is a caveat to that. Now, then the second symptoms which come to us are respiratory symptoms. A child with fever with respiratory symptom, we only admit cases of severe pneumonia. We also are, over the last 5 years, getting a resurgence of diphtheria patients coming to us. So all diphtherias are admitted. All severe pneumonias are admitted, which look like severe pneumonia, could be bronchiolitis, could be anything, or empyemas and complicated pneumonias are admitted. There do we come to know etiology? In upper respiratory, in respiratory symptom, we have an ongoing surveillance for H1N1. So all the viruses are investigated when there is a pneumonia season or where there is a H1N1 epidemic or pandemic, we get those. And diphtheria, the funny thing is that you see a membrane, but the culture comes to be negative. So what is the other way out? So we have a WHO diphtheria surveillance network where we see a rise in the antibody titer if the patient is alive for some time. And then that's a confirmed case of diphtheria. The next set of patients we get are patients with fever, without AES, without respiratory symptom, but sepsis-like presentation. And these patients come with septic shock, require fluids, require intensive care. And in these patients, by and large, the biomarkers are definitely elevated, counts are elevated. Very rarely we reach to a diagnosis. We manage such patients as it is. Then we get patients with skin manifestations. We get a lot of dengue. We get chikungunya. We get parvo with skin manifestations occasionally coming positive. And then we have abdominal symptoms in which typhi dot is coming positive, I think in almost 80% of patients whom you send typhi dot, it comes positive. So it's not specific, as I discussed with the previous speaker, for typhoid any longer, because many children come out typhi dot positive. They are not typhoid, there's something else in our place. Then we have over last few years seen an increase in proportion of liver abscesses coming in our abdominal symptoms, in our tertiary care. So one, two, multiple huge liver abscess, which needs interventional radiologist treatment with pigtail catheter and drainage going on for 2 to 3 weeks with those liver abscesses in our center. Then the other symptoms which we get are bone and joint non-specific, which would be tubercular or other bone and joint involvement or viral. But what is of interest is that when we get fever without localizing symptom, we divide it, or intuitively we treating pediatricians say, okay, when it's a fever without localizing symptom, we see it comes to us when it's more than 14 days of duration. When it's less than 14 days of duration, it's all treated below. Does receive antibiotics, all of them below. Is hardly investigated or investigated for so many things that I've seen children with upper respiratory symptom repeatedly getting typhi dot positive, repeatedly being treated for typhoid, where we know it is not typhoid, it is upper respiratory symptom at all. So certain tests should be sort of banned or whatever. It should be given to a syndromic type of patient and not indiscriminately used by the pediatricians. Then when the patient comes from below, what filters and reaches us after 14 days Our diseases like zoonosis, like scrub, like leptospirosis, we also get kalazar coming to us from adjoining parts of the country. And we then get immune system disorders and malignancies with more than 14 days of duration coming to us. So the issue is, when I thought we wanted to develop a protocol, the protocol cannot be pan-India, considering it can't be global protocol. There are so many variations and differences. There are so many ifs and buts, not only for the use of antibiotics, but I guess prescription of a diagnostic test. It shouldn't be prescribed, for example, typhi dot, why should it be done to a child with upper respiratory symptom? It should be given to a child with a different syndromic profile and not to such a child. So with this, what is our vaccination status? We have a national eradication program against measles. Rubella has been added to it. We do see measles and rubellas coming, but then there is an outbreak response by the public health facility. So there's no problem in recognizing measles. Rubella is milder disease. That's basically for congenital rubella. They are doing it. We get it. Now, the interesting part is that India has launched a big health insurance policy called Ayushman Bharat. In this Ayushman Bharat, people who are below a certain income level will get free health care by the government. Now, to develop this free health care, give free health care by the government asked us pediatricians to develop standard treatment workflow. And that standard treatment workflow would guide us in our facilities for treating, for investigating, and the reimbursement would be linked to the standard treatment workflow. So if your treatment is not in the standard treatment workflow, or you have ordered an investigation out of that, you will not be reimbursed through the government policy. Now, you can understand the problems we had when we have evolved a standard treatment workflow for fever. And that would be released on 26th, which is our Independence Day. We don't know how well it will do. We went through all the literature that has been available to us. We still have a treatment workflow in which we've divided less than 7 days and more than 7 days, with localization, without localization. And we have divided investigations into essential, desirable, and optional, giving some freedom to the clinician to manage patient appropriately. Otherwise, if we don't do essential and desirable and optional, there were chances that we would undertreat, perhaps wrongly treat, or not diagnose certain set of patients. So with this background, I have got some data to show you what we have. Well, this is what I think Florence sent us. What is our capacity? We have all culture capacities, and we have the highest microbiology lab, virology lab. Our virology is accredited, and we detect all the viruses. There is a Gates Foundation as well, national AES program, AES etiology program, in which across many cities and states of India, you are taking CSF and doing a panel test for the etiology. And that the center for that is NIMHANS Bangalore, which is the coordinating center. But we do it here. Then we have the etiology of pneumonia by SEMR task force. Bacterial center is coordinated by CMC Vellore. And the viral is by National Virology Laboratory in Pune. So there are basic works going on. But there's nothing going on fever without localizing symptom. Now, if you see, this is what you wanted us. When you asked us how many acute undifferentiated fever we have, you would see that in our admission, we only admitted so far total number of very few cases, 10 to 11 cases. And there was a large sex male predominance of all the cases who were admitted. And if you go through what are the investigations, etc., I haven't shown you the investigation lines. They turned out to be immune. A couple were positive for parvo by PCR, and then the parvo load was done, and parvo load came out to be X and Y, and then they were managed. Now, when you told us fever with ARDS, acute fever with respiratory distress, you would see that acute fever, febrile encephalopathy, acute encephalitic syndrome, fever with multi-organs dysfunction was actually picked up from their case records as sepsis, septic sepsis. These are the number of cases. And with other gastrointestinal symptoms would be a chronic protracted diarrhea in malnourished children. So what we see is that number of children less than 5 years, more than 5 years, and I only have patients' pediatric data with me. But every day when you tell us how many patients do we see every day, we have this, every day we have a, we are tertiary level, we are seeing about 8,000 to 10,000 new patients every day. Out of 8,000 to 10,000 new patients every day, approximately 10% are admitted. We have a large tertiary care hospital with 4,400 beds, out of which we have about 250 intensive care beds. So all the intensive cares, and it's not pediatric, it's adult pediatric intensive care wherever it is. So there's a large number of admission and large number, but remember the spectrum of patients that come to us is different. The spectrum which goes at district hospital is different, that goes at secondary hospital is different, and those patients seen by a pediatrician is totally different. And what I feel and which all of us feel is whenever a pediatrician or a lower level facility sees a fever with localizing symptom, they move the patient up. They try to treat a patient which is fever without differentiating symptoms. Whenever a differentiating symptom comes, either they feel confident or they don't feel confident, they move the patient up. By that time, a lot of efforts are lost, a lot of antibiotics have been pumped in. And when we get patients of pneumonia or meningitis, no patient is antibiotic naive. They have received the choicest of antibiotics because there's no restrictions on use of antibiotic. I wish there was, but there isn't. So I'm happy to answer any questions you want on my Indian setup.
Thank you very much, Shally. Is any question? Yes, Graciela.
Nice presentation and impressed 4,500.